For 12 years, this is the routine that Pete Janaris has had to accept. Kidney dialysis 3 times a week. As vital as it is, he admits it can wear a guy down.
I mean, even myself, I knew that, man, you know, it's taking a toll on my body.
Pete has dealt with kidney disease most of his life, even receiving kidney transplants before. But this time was different. He was told he would almost certainly reject any donor organ.
Not many people understand, oh, you need a kidney, you get on the list, 2 years later you get your kidney, you're fine. You know, that's not the story for everybody.
About 80% of people who've had a previous transplant have actually antibodies against other tissue types. They also could have been exposed to the foreign tissue types by a blood transfusion or even pregnancy.
I was devastated, shocked, didn't really see it coming.
Pregnancy delivered a double blow to Anissa Swanigan. After giving birth a second time, her weakened heart condition advanced to heart failure, and complications scarred her liver so badly it was failing too. Doctors told her she needed a double organ transplant.
That's the only way you're going to survive.
She had 2 big reasons to survive, her 2 little boys. But again, high levels of antibodies made her a very poor transplant candidate. Antibodies are a good thing when they help us fight disease. Vaccines, for example, trigger our immune systems to create antibodies. But for some of those waiting to receive life-saving organs, Mayo Clinic transplant surgeon and immunology researcher Mark Stiegel says antibodies become the enemy.
It's a big problem. There are about 9,000 people on the kidney transplant list in the United States right now who have really high levels of antibody to the point that they can't really get a transplant.
Pete's in that category, called highly sensitized. So Dr. Stiegel and his team did a variety of things in advance to tip the odds in his favor. They carefully selected a living donor for which Pete would have the fewest antibodies. Also, drug research has found a way to reduce antibody-caused rejection rates from 40% to less than 10%.
One of the drugs that we were the first to use is a drug called eculizumab. If we give this drug, the antibody binds the kidney, but it doesn't cause the damage.
Pete also went through numerous rounds of an antibody filtering process called a plasma exchange. Then, to try to halt the production of new antibodies in his bone marrow, Dr. Stiegel turned to an FDA-approved clinical trial at Mayo Clinic using a powerful drug.
A drug called Velcade, which is actually used in the treatment of cancers of these antibody-secreting cells. But, of course, these are not cancer cells. These are normal cells.
Anissa also underwent drug and plasma exchange therapies, but her antibody levels were so high, doctors worried her body might still reject the donor organs.
By the time the liver went in, the heart would already be irreversibly damaged by the antibodies. So we reversed the process and did the liver transplant first.
Why? Surgical director of heart and lung transplantation at Mayo Clinic, Dr. Richard Daly, says the liver filters antibodies. In combined kidney-liver or heart-liver transplants, his team had observed a reduction in antibodies to that donor. However, in multiple organ transplants, hearts generally have to go in first because their tissues are more time sensitive. How does the Mayo team get around that?
Choreograph the whole process. We have to have the donor close enough by. We have to have the procurement done and be really completely ready for the organs when they arrive.
It seemed brilliant. Brilliant minds that they collaborated and they got together and figured out how to do this thing.
And I took a chance. I didn't have anything else to lose, so either I stay on dialysis or a miracle happens and I get this kidney.
Innovation that makes a world of difference, one patient at a time.